So this video is going to be a tutorial to go over how to make a PID control loop. When I was first trying to make these loops, I had a lot of trouble finding good online tutorials, so hopefully this video will solve that problem. So a PID loop stands for a proportional, integral, and derivative loop. So as its name would suggest, it has three parts, and we calculate these three parts together, and then we calculate the three parts and then add them together to get the value that we send to our motors. So why do we use these loops? A PID loop is used to get from a current sensor value. So it has to be a measured value. It has to be something you're getting from a sensor or something that you're measuring physically. So a current value to a desired value. So it gets us from, in my case, our current velocity of a flywheel to a desired velocity of the flywheel. And when you're doing this, it's always best to leave your measurements in raw sensor values. So here, velocity is in ticks per second, because that's much more accurate than feet per second, because you can have a larger number, so you get more digits of accuracy. If you use raw data value, nothing is lost. And so this bit of math here converts power, which is in feet per second, to a desired ticks per second. So the entire PID loop operates on the error between where I am and where I want to be. So error, therefore, is calculated as where I want to be minus where I am as measured by a sensor. So the difference between desired value and actual value. So we calculate our three parts based on the constants. K denotes a constant. So that's KP, KI, and KD. The constant of proportion, the constant of integration, and the constant of derivation. And these are experimentally determined. And finding these values is called tuning a PID loop, and you have to do that for yourself. You can't just use someone else's values. They change, you have to find that out for yourself, and that's called tuning. So the three parts are the proportion, the integral, and the derivative. And so proportion is a straight proportion of the error. It's just that simple. Error times a value, it's a proportion. So proportion is linear to error. And what this means is the amount we're adjusting by, the power we're moving at, is proportional to how far away we are from our target. So if we're 8 feet away from our target, we're going to move pretty fast, probably at full speed. But if we're 1 foot away, then it'll be a really low value. And that really low value might not be enough to move the robot, which is why we have the integral term. So the integral term is the accumulated error, so this variable is error total, times the constant of integration. So in order to get the accumulated error, every time through the loop, we just add error. So we just say, error total plus equals error. And because my flywheel has two wheels, I have a left wheel and a right wheel, and I have two PID loops, so that's why there's error L and error R. That's just a separate loop for each side of the shooter. So we're only really concerned with one side of that. So in our example, we're trying to move 8 feet, then we get 1 foot away, and the value coming out of here is now so low that we can't actually move. Say we're sending a value of 10 to our motors. Well, our motors aren't moving then. But error total is gonna add up. So we're 1 foot away, then it adds that again, so it's 2, then it's 3, then it's 4, then it's 5. And eventually, this value will get high enough to move our robot. So the power we're sending to our motors will gradually increase until it gets big enough to move the robot, hopefully pulling it across that last foot. That's what it's designed to do. Now this term is very, very dangerous. It's really easy, like when we're 8 feet away, for the integral to grow very quickly, because instead of adding 1 plus 1 plus 1, we're adding 8 plus 8 plus 8 plus 8. This can spiral out of control very quickly and cause you to run your motors at full speed until they die. So it's important that we control the integral term, and we'll go over some ways to control it later. The last term is the derivative term, and the derivative term is the rate of change of error times a constant. So in order to calculate rate of change, at the end of every loop, we set a variable last error to the error right now, and then at the beginning of the next loop, we calculate a new error value, and then in the derivative term, we do error minus last error, and then we multiply that times a constant. And the point of the derivative term is to kind of keep in check the rest of the loop. So if we start approaching our target really, really fast, if error is changing quickly, that means we're in danger of overshooting our target, which is a bad thing. So this will slow us down. Hopefully, derivative, if we're approaching our target, will be negative, because we have our current error minus our last error. And if we're getting closer to our target, last error will be greater than current error, and this term will wind up being negative. So it will contribute negatively to our total motor value. And that's what I mean when I say the derivative term pulls it back. So if we're speeding towards our target, it says, whoa, whoa, slow down. That way we don't overshoot. So let's go back to controlling the integral term. So in our example, the place where the integral term really became useful was when we were 1 foot away from our target, at a point where the proportional value got small enough that it couldn't move the robot. So we don't need the proportional, we don't need the integral term until that point. We don't need it when the error is large, because then it will just accumulate wildly and go out of control. So that's what this if loop does. We're only accumulating error if error is less than a value I set, integral active zone. So in the case of this example, integral active zone is 1 foot per second. So if I want to be going at 15 feet per second, I don't actually start accumulating integral values until I'm at 14 feet per second. And that way, I don't accumulate huge integral values until I get, or I don't accumulate huge integral values while I'm far away. And then the second part of this is, when error equals zero, everything should equal zero. Error equals zero, everything should equal zero, because we don't want to be moving, because we're where we want to be. We've hit our target, so we don't want to move anything. So also, when error equals zero, we set the integral term to zero, because sometimes the integral term takes a while to adjust, because it accumulates over time, and then it takes time to like de-accumulate, and we don't want that. So as soon as we hit error equals zero, the integral term just goes away. It hits zero. And we do the exact same thing with the derivative term. Once we hit zero, everything shuts off. But if we overshoot, then error is no longer equal to zero, and these things can start accumulating again. The other thing we do to keep in check our integral term is a hard limit. The integral term just cannot get too large, so we cap it off at a maximum value. And commonly that maximum value will be 50 divided by whatever you're using as KI, the constant of integration. So if error is greater than that, we just cap it off there and say, you can't go any higher. And that will keep it from blowing crazy out of control. Then at the end of our loop, we just say the motors, or at the end of our loop, we just say the power we're sending to our motors, which is this variable here, is equal to the proportion term, is equal to the proportion term plus the integral term plus the derivative term. And we just add them all together and send that value to our motors. And that's the end of it. So now let's go over tuning a PID loop. PID loops must be tuned for every different loop. These can change based on the wait time. So you have to have a wait time at the end of your loop. Otherwise, you'll eat up your processor speed, and motors can't update faster than every 20 milliseconds anyway. So having a value smaller than that is a waste. So the constants will change based on wait times. They'll change based on the number of motors, the amount of torque, a million things, what the target is. So you have to tune these manually. So the method that most of us will probably wind up using is the manual tuning method. And so to do that, we set all of our values to zero. And then we set KP to something small. Okay? And the smaller you set KP in the beginning, or the smaller your increments are, the better accuracy you'll get. So you set KP and you slowly increase it. You slowly increase the value. So when your values are low, you will most likely be undershooting your target. You won't actually get to your target because of what we said earlier, where you're 1 foot away and the value coming out of your KP term isn't great enough to do anything, and we don't have an integral term right here because it's zero, so we're multiplying times this and everything's winding up zero. So hopefully we'll be undershooting. Eventually this will get large enough, so we keep trying higher and higher values, and maybe we want to be really accurate, so 0.11, 0.12, like this, very slowly increasing our values until we discover a point where it starts to oscillate, call it 0.2. So now we actually overshoot our target, and then we come back too far, we undershoot, then we overshoot again and undershoot, overshoot. So we start oscillating about our target. So this is the point where we stop increasing our KP. and we start increasing our KD. And again, if you use smaller, if you increase by smaller amounts, you will probably get better accuracy, but it will take longer time. Okay, so we start increasing this until we find a point where the oscillation stops. All right, call it 0.09. And we say, great, good, oscillation has stopped. Well, now we go back and start increasing our KP value again until we get a new oscillation. Call it 0.28. All right, we got a new oscillation. Okay, so we go back and we start increasing KD again until the oscillation stops. All right, so we have 0.28 for a KP value, and we're started oscillating, so we increased KD to 0.15 and the oscillation stopped. Fantastic. All right, try it again. So we keep increasing this, and let's say we get to 0.3 and we get a new oscillation. Okay, we try and do the same thing. We try and increase KD again to account, and no matter how high we make KD, we go up by little tiny steps and we keep going, and the oscillation never stops. Okay, well, now we've reached a point of no return, sort of. So we've gone too high in our KP. We can't fix it now. So we go back to the last KD value that worked and the last KP value that worked, and we leave that as that. Okay, so that's the best we can get out of our KP and KD. And now we start messing with KI. So KI is likely to be very, very small, something maybe even like this. Okay, so it's good to move in small increments when you're adjusting your KI value. And you want to adjust the KI value until everything smooths out. So chances are, with just the KD and the KP terms, you're going to overshoot your target, come back down, probably undershoot it by a little bit, and then slowly ramp back up until you're at your target. And the KI term is supposed to kind of smooth that out and keep you from overshooting like that. And it just kind of flattens out the entire curve and makes everything nicer. So increase these by very small amounts until you think that it's leveled out. The curve is very flat. And sometimes that's like a very subjective thing, but it is what it is. So that's what that should be. And once that's done, your PID loop should work. So you found all three values that work, and that should be the end of it. And have fun with your new great PID loop.